That infamous quote was made by Chris Satchel, who was working for the Xbox Advanced Technology Group in 2005. In part one of this series, we covered the Xbox 360 and how the DVD drive was targeted by hackers with custom firmware code that exploited the drive to run backup games. While this method proved to be very popular, it did not open up the system for homebrew, which is what thrived on the original Xbox for many years before. The DVD exploits, as clever as they were, only allowed for piracy, which meant that there was no ability for the homebrew or Linux community to take advantage of the system. If we compare the Sony PlayStation 3 and the Xbox 360, both share similar specifications, but the PlayStation 3 came out of the box with a Linux distribution, a sandbox for the development of homebrew, called OtherOS. The Xbox 360, on the other hand, had nothing for the bedroom coder to play around in. Microsoft had promised the homebrew community to open up the Xbox 360 to allow for the development of homebrew, but this ended up in the form of XNA Game Studio Express. In 2006 at the launch, Peter Moore, then vice president of Xbox, said, "XNA Game Studio Express is our first step of creating a YouTube for video games. It will give you everything you need to bring your games to life on the Xbox 360. XNA Game Studio Express was a welcome addition to the Xbox 360, but it wasn't what the homebrew community was looking for. It's essentially a framework of portable libraries that require C#.NET that allowed you to build games on Windows and run them on the Xbox 360 or Windows phones. It only allowed restricted access to the hardware, and while there were some really cool games developed for it, some of which have become successful such as Bastion and Dust: The Elysian Tale, it also required a $99 membership fee per year, and it certainly would not allow you to run Linux. OtherOS on the PlayStation 3 came with the console and was free of charge. The Xbox 360 was several times more powerful than the original Xbox, and came with 8 times the amount of RAM. This meant that it should make for a significantly better homebrew device for media players, emulation, and homebrew games. Many of us from the OG Xbox days, if you were around in those days, wanted to see homebrew on the Xbox 360 as the natural progression of things. But it was clear that Microsoft had invested so much time and money into the security system of the Xbox 360 that it wasn't going to be easy. And we found out very quickly that things were going to take a lot longer than anticipated. Given this, the motivation to exploit the Xbox 360 was high. There must have been a way. But Microsoft had spent millions securing the hardware. Here's a quick summary. The boot process of the Xbox 360 has a secure chain of trust, and this time, all of it is contained inside the physical CPU itself. Unlike the original Xbox, where it was possible to snoop data along the bus, nothing is sent over the bus at all. Furthermore, the Xeon CPU contains a unique key that's tied to the console itself, as well as e-fuses, which would enforce updates by blowing a fuse, and this meant that you could never downgrade back to a previous version. The Xbox 360 Hypervisor sits in RAM, and it's only 128 kilobytes in size. It will only ever allow for signed code executables to run, signed that is, with Microsoft's private key. All runtime memory is encrypted, and there's no way to alter RAM, and there's certainly no way to execute it. But if you can somehow get access to the Hypervisor, you can have full control of the machine. With current gen gaming, it's hard to believe anymore, but the Xbox 360 had 18 games at launch. Some were cross-gen titles with the original Xbox, others were sequels to popular franchises, and some were new IP. One game in the launch lineup that was popular was Peter Jackson's King Kong. It was a fun first-person adventure title and easy achievement points. It was worth a playthrough just for that. Although the Xbox 360 game executables are signed, game assets such as level data, textures, models, audio, and shaders are not. This meant that a game that may have had an exploitable asset may open up the door for code execution on the system. But even if you did have an exploitable asset on the game, wouldn't the Hypervisor shut it down anyway? Well, yes. And no. Microsoft shipped the Xbox 360 in November of 2005, but in October of 2006, with the version update 4532, a bug was introduced that would allow for complete system control. How did this happen? One of the main tasks of the hypervisor is to handle all system calls, in other words, calls to kernel mode functions. In the update 4532, an exploit was found that would make it possible for the hypervisor to system call into user memory and execute code. This is what was known as the King Kong exploit. The exploitable shader on the game was patched to load arbitrary code with full privileges and access to hardware. But if you had to modify a shader on the game disk to launch unsigned code, that would mean that you would need to use a backup copy of the game, which would not boot on a retail Xbox 360. But there is a simple workaround to this. A hacked DVD firmware that boots backups would easily handle this. The King Kong exploit was developed in November of 2006, but was not disclosed publicly until February of 2007. Microsoft had already been made aware of the exploit, and it was patched even before it was announced to the public. And because of eFuse technology, there was no way to go back to this firmware after you had updated. The King Kong glitch was a good first step, but it was discovered too late. All was not lost, however. In fact, far from it. One of the chips in the Xbox 360 is known as the SMC, or System Management Controller. This is a fairly common chip with most home computers. It controls all the power functions, controls the fans, handles system resets and various other commands. The Xbox 360 also had a Jtag port for the GPU and CPU. Jtag is an interface that's used for programming and debugging. But for security reasons, both the GPU and CPU Jtag ports are very quickly disabled during the boot sequence. But if we draw our attention back to the SMC, it's possible to override this disabling of the Jtag ports and apply a timing hack to bypass the eFuses and load kernel 5532, the same kernel as used by the King Kong exploits as before, but without requiring the original game disk. This was all done before the bootloader could shut down the Jtag port. This process would normally make the GPU become unstable, so as part of this process, the system is soft rebooted. From here, the system boots up to a patched kernel and hypervisor, which enables the use of homebrew. To explain how this timing attack works in more detail, the base kernel comes shipped with all Xbox 360s and is always present. When a firmware update is applied, it's essentially appended onto the base kernel rather than overwritten. This is likely for security reasons. To deal with the problem of not being able to downgrade to 4532 due to burnt eFuses, if the Xbox 360 CPU key is known, then it can easily bypass this check. This timing exploit works by extracting the base kernel and patching it with the current firmware. This would still not boot because the system would show the current version. The firmware is checked against what's known as a lockdown counter, a check to determine the number of eFuses that are still available. This corresponds to the kernel version. This value is encrypted, but it's only 16 bytes long. Therefore, to determine a hash lockout counter value that matches the base kernel's only requires 4,096 tries to decrypt the hash and allow this modified kernel to boot. Custom hardware was designed and in conjunction with the SMC enabling the GPU and CPU Jtag ports would open up the King Kong exploit once again without requiring the game or the shader as from before. This exploit is known as the Jtag hack. It rendered all Xbox 360s before December 2007's update to be vulnerable. But around the same time, Microsoft updated the hardware with the Zephyr, Opus, and then Jasper models. All of these were patched against the timing hack. In early 2008, Microsoft had completely patched the Jtag exploit. If you had a Jtagable Xbox 360, you were in luck. But only a very small group of users compared to the entire user base were using Jtag Xbox 360s. It was also much harder for the average user to mod their Xbox 360s as it required multiple steps and more chances of failure. Coupled with the red ring of death issues, it meant that many users chose to keep away. After Microsoft fixed the Jtag exploit, it seemed as if that was it. No more hacks. A few false starts, but Microsoft seemingly had won the battle. However, in August of 2011, a new exploit appeared out of nowhere. This time, it was a brute force attack on the CPU's thread management code, which is stored in the CPU itself. The exploit works by first setting the Xeon CPU's clock speed to the lowest possible so that it would still run signed code. This was performed by the scaler chip, known as the HANA, which has the CPU speed control built into the chip itself. Now, in this scenario, the Xbox 360 would normally think that there was a problem, and after three attempts to boot into the kernel, it would shut itself down. But the exploit allows the system to retry as many times as needed. The CPU has a reset test point, which is then used to quickly reset the processor, and this is where the exploit comes in. Like any CPU, when it's executing code, it's running an active thread. But by adjusting the timing to reset the CPU every 100 nanoseconds, on successful reset, the active thread and registers are cleared out. And when the thread is dropped, the system perceives this as a successful status check and then proceeds to run modified code and take over the system and ultimately gain hypervisor access. Known as the RGH or reset glitch hack, it breathed new life into the Xbox 360 homebrew scene and worked on all model Xbox 360s except for the older Xenon models. The RGH method, however, is not perfect. The main issue is that it's slow, and in some instances there is a significant wait time for the Xbox 360 to glitch. Sometimes it never happens at all, and you must power off and try again. The RGH method was refined into the RJTAG method, which takes the same JTAG bootloaders from the King Kong days and combines it with the CPU thread drop exploit and use more sophisticated FPGA hardware to manage the exploit itself. And as of the making of this episode, the RJTAG method is still unpatched. Now, I do want to mention there are other exploit methods that came out after the reset glitch hack, including the RJTAG that we touched on. In general, they're just iterations or tweaks or little differences of the original exploit discoveries themselves. There's really nothing new that has been discovered since the reset glitch hack itself, and I don't anticipate that that will change in the future, considering that the Xbox 360 is all but a dead system in 2019. The reset glitch hack ultimately brought homebrew to all. No longer did you need to resort to using an older JTAG Xbox 360, which had elevated risks of rendering of death. The developer of the RGH, known as Gleekly, also worked on open source ports that ran under Linux, known as libxenon. From here, work was done on bringing Nintendo 64 and Dreamcast emulation across to the Xbox 360. As for the homebrew scene itself, it wasn't as prominent as the original Xbox days, but there were still some great things to play. You can still do some awesome things with a homebrew-enabled Xbox 360 even in 2019, and this will be covered in a future episode. Ultimately, it's unknown that if Microsoft gave homebrew developers what they were looking for, if this amount of discovery and work to defeat the hypervisor would have occurred. The PlayStation 3 seemingly was secure enough, until other OS was removed, and that drove a targeted push to defeat its security within months of its removal. But to their credit, Microsoft did provide a better way to write code on the Xbox One that hobbyists could use with their dev mode, and one thing I'd like to see further refined in future generations of their consoles.
So there you have it, guys. That's the story of the Xbox 360 hypervisor security that was ultimately defeated initially with the King Kong shader patch, which then was utilized in the JTAG exploit, as well as the reset glitch hack from 2011 that came out and really just kind of took over the exploit methods on the Xbox 360. Now, I did mention that there is a part one of this series. If you haven't seen, I'll leave a link in the description below. It's all about the DVD firmware security that was ultimately defeated very, very quickly, actually, in early 2006, with lots and lots of custom firmwares that were really, you know, one step ahead of Microsoft and trying to avoid things like Xbox Live bans and stuff like that. It's very much relevant to this discussion, and it does have some overlap in some of the exploits that were discovered, particularly around the King Kong shader exploit originally in 2007. Well, guys, that will do it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. Let me know what you thought about it in the comments below. If you liked it, you know what to do. Give me a thumbs up, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Bye for now.